In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God, Amen. We will continue our Bible study from the Gospel of St. John. Tonight, we will study John chapter 20. St. John opens the first chapter of his Gospel by proclaiming the eternal existence of the Lord Jesus Christ, when he said, "In the beginning was the Word." But this is completely different beginning in comparison to the opening chapters in the three other Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. So how St. John started his Gospel is totally different than how Matthew, Mark, and Luke started their Gospels. However, in the closing chapters of the Gospel of St. John, he wrote about the same event recorded in the other Gospels. All of them, the four evangelists, wrote about resurrection. Why? Because the resurrection represents the focus of the act of salvation. As St. Paul said, if Christ did not rise, then your faith is in vain. Chapter 20 from the Gospel of St. John explained to us the story of resurrection. And by the way, this is the Gospel that we read it in the liturgy of the Feast of Resurrection. The outline of the chapter, from verse 1 to verse 10, the empty tomb. From verse 11 to verse 18, Mary Magdalene sees the risen Lord. From verse 19 to 23, the apostles commissioned by God, by the Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 24 to 29, seeing and believing. And the last two verses, 30 and 31, that you may believe. So, God willing, today we'll study the first 18 verses, the empty tomb from verse 1 to 10, then Mary Magdalene sees the risen Lord from 11 to 18. Start from verse 1. Now, on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early, while it was still dark, and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. St. John seems to indicate that Mary Magdalene is alone, although St. Matthew mentioned that she was with the other Mary, Mary of Clopas, who accompanied her or followed soon after her. If Mary Magdalene went alone, then the other Mary, Mary of Clopas, followed soon after her. The other Gospels actually listed Mary Magdalene as one of several women went together to the tomb on the first day of the week, Sunday. So it may be that Mary, or both Marys, went first before the dawn, and the rest of the women followed after them. So we can conclude maybe there are two or three groups of women went to the tomb on that morning. So here St. John speaks only about one group, or about maybe one person, Mary Magdalene, who was especially prominent in her story. But we may ask, who is missing from all these groups of women? Saint Mary, the Mother of God, is missing, because she knows that her son rose from the dead and he is no longer in the tomb. She didn't have to go to the tomb to believe in the resurrection of Christ. She already knew that her son rose from the dead. Mary Magdalene, she was from a fishing village on the shores of the Galilee. And Mary Magdalene actually is considered a central figure in the story of resurrection. She is mentioned 12 times in the Gospels, 12 times in the story of resurrection. She came as soon as the Sabbath of the Old Testament was over. She came on Sunday early morning, even it was dark yet. And according to the literal application of the law, it would have been incorrect to visit the tomb on the Sabbath. So she waited until the new Sabbath day, because Sunday now, the day of resurrection, became the new Sabbath. As you know, Sabbath means rest. So the day of rest, the day of the Lord, is the day of resurrection. This is the day which the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. So, the gospel here begins with the first day in the new week. First day in the new week. As if the gospel proclaims to us a new resurrected life and a new world. The world changed after the resurrection of Christ. Because since that time, Christians have designated Sunday as the day of the Lord, as the day of rest. It is celebrated in the memory or in the reliving of the resurrection of the Lord. And it's called the Lord's Day in Greek, Kyriaki, as we read in Revelation chapter 1, verse 10. Verse 2, then she ran after she saw the stone was taken away from the tomb and she saw the tomb is empty. Then she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved and said to them, they have taken away the Lord out of the tomb and we do not know where they have laid him. Mary Magdalene ran and came to those who would be most interested. And without introduction, out of breath and anxious, crying out, she told them, they have taken away the Lord out of the tomb. Evidently, she had no idea that a resurrection had taken place. And I want you to notice that she told them, we do not know where they have laid him. She did not say, I do not know, we. The plural proved actually that Mary Magdalene went with group of women. So all of them did not know where they have laid him. St. John's Gospel actually here implies what the other evangelists mentioned in their Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, that there were other women went to the tomb very early in the morning. Some believe that Mary Magdalene ran to Peter and John, while the other women ran to report the news to the rest of the disciples. Verse 3. Peter therefore went out, and the other disciple, John, and were going to the tomb. So they both ran together, and the other disciple, John, outran Peter, and came to the tomb first. And he, stooping down and looking in, saw the linen cloth lying there, yet he did not go in. The details of the visit of Peter and John are peculiar to this gospel. No other gospel actually mentioned these details except Saint John. Saint Luke mentioned briefly the visit of Saint Peter only. But here we have the whole scene pictured with all accuracy, because John himself was eyewitness. He was one of these two. So he wrote the detail of what happened. John, the other disciple, outran Peter. John was younger, more active than Peter. That's why he outran Peter. John is restrained by wonder at what he sees when he saw the tomb empty, the linen clothes in one area folded, and the handkerchief on the other area. So, taken by wonder, he waited for Peter to arrive. In some translation, it's not only did not go in, but he dared not to go in. He dared not to go in. Maybe out of respect of Peter, or he was taken by the surprise. Or maybe he trusted the words of Mary Magdalene that the body is no longer in the tomb. And this means Jesus, for John, means Jesus rose from the dead, as we read in verse 9. Verse 6, then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb, and he saw the linen clothes lying there, and the handkerchief that had been around his head, not lying with the linen clothes, but folded together in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, John, who came to the tomb first, went in also, and he saw and believed. Believed in what? Verse 9, for as yet they did not know the scripture that he must rise again from the dead. So, as soon as Peter came, he stepped inside, and John followed him. Both of them saw and believed, because the body was no longer in the tomb. The tomb is empty. Saint John, before the arrival of Peter, was standing there in awe and meditation, thinking about what he is seeing here. But Peter actually, with his natural impulsiveness, ran inside the tomb to see what's going on. So both apostles, John and Peter, acted typically and according to their character. And actually now we have two or three witnesses, Peter, John, and Mary Magdalene. As the Bible says, by mouth of two or three witnesses, everything is confirmed. So now actually we have three witnesses together confirming to us the resurrection of the Lord. Both saw the linen in which the body was wrapped, but the body was gone. So the linen is there, but the body was gone, which was a sign that the body was not stolen. Because if anybody is stealing the body, why he would leave the linen? He will take the body with the linen, everything. So the fact they found the linen in its place, it's a proof of the resurrection of the Lord. And I want to bring to your attention, when Lazarus rose from the dead, he came out of the tomb wrapped with the grave clothes. But Jesus left the linen cloth in the tomb. Why? Because Lazarus rose with mortal body. He lived some years and died after this. But Jesus is the first one who rose with the glorified body, and he never dies again. Some scholars argue and say that John did not suddenly came to believe in the resurrection, but he was convinced that the body was stolen, as Mary Magdalene said. But of course, this not right. Early church father made the suggestion that John and Peter, when they saw the burial clothes, this actually supported their belief in the resurrection of Christ. Because if the body was taken by robbers, they would have taken the body wrapped in the clothes to avoid drawing attention to themselves. St. John Chrysostom actually says, if anyone had removed the body, he would not have stripped it first, nor would he have taken the trouble to remove and roll up the linen cloth and the handkerchief and put it in a place by itself. So, early church father also suggested that it was the position and the form of the clothes, not only their presence, that convinced John and Peter with the resurrection. Think with me, if there is a thief, would he fold the linen clothes and fold the handkerchief? And why he put this in one place and why he put this in the other place? So not only the presence of the clothes, but actually their position, their manner, their form is a strong indication for the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's why actually the early church fathers, which was proved later on in the study of the Shroud of Turin, that the Lord Jesus Christ in his resurrection, he emerged from the burial clothes in a supernatural manner, which allowed him to pass through the clothes and leaving them virtually in place like an empty cocoon. So the Lord actually, as he came out of the tomb, out of the stone, he also came out of the clothes. He did not move the clothes from its place. And St. John made an emphasis that the handkerchief that had been around his head was folded and in another place. What he saw was significant. The linen wrapping lying and the napkin which had been on his head not lying with the linen cloth but separately folded up in a place by itself. The first circumstance related to the linen was evidence that the body had not been hastily snatched away from the tomb. Whether the authorities or robbers want to steal the body, they would have taken it with the linen. But the second circumstance about the handkerchief gave them even stronger proof that there had been no hurry. Who will fold the handkerchief and place in its place? So these two circumstances, the handkerchief here and the linen here, are indication of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. The handkerchief was neatly folded and laid in a place by itself, the linen being in another place. In this description and in this verse, the detailed and exact knowledge and remembrance of John as an eyewitness reaches its peak. He remembered exactly what he saw in the empty tomb. And the very fact that the napkin was folded did not escape his eye, the eye of St. John, nor fade from his memory. And that's why he mentioned even the handkerchief was folded. They felt in the tomb as if they were in a chamber where one had stripped or separated himself of one set of garment to assume another. As Jesus actually left this garment to assume the another, the glorified body of resurrection. And here, John had arrived, as we said, had arrived first as he raced toward the tomb. But Peter showed more courage as he stepped into the tomb looking for the body. He wanted to check the matter in all its possibilities. So, John's speed encouraged Peter to move more quickly, while Peter's courage led John to step inside the tomb. So both of them complemented one another. As we read in Luke chapter 24, verse 12, Peter saw and marveled, and John saw and believed. So both of them believed in the resurrection. And he saw and believed. Not believed what Mary has said, they stole the body. It's clear in verse 9. But they believed in the resurrection. I am sure, standing and gazing at the folded handkerchief, John saw the truth. Jesus has risen from the dead and freed himself from all this wrapping. John and Peter saw there were no signs of haste or confusion or a searched tomb. And verse 9 explains that they did not fully understand those scriptures of the Old Testament and the types or the symbols of the Old Testament about the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. But let us ask a question. Did they really have no understanding that Jesus would rise from the dead? Jesus actually spoke about his resurrection several times. The Lord Jesus Christ prepared them for this event. So, they heard the word, the resurrection. They knew it, but they did not understand it. Even the chief priests, according to the Gospel of St. Matthew chapter 27, from verse 62 to 66, the chief priests and the Pharisees knew about the resurrection of Christ. That's why they went to Pilate and asked him to guard and seal the tomb, lest the disciples steal his body and say he rose from the dead. And Jesus himself spoke several times repeatedly to the disciples about his resurrection. So they knew the word, but they could not understand it. And Jesus actually did not only predict his resurrection, but he also emphasized that his resurrection from the dead would be the prophetic sign to authenticate his claim that he is Messiah. As if he is saying, if I did not rise, don't believe that I am the Messiah. But if I rise from the dead, then I am the true Messiah. So now actually, at the tomb, they did not only believe, but also they recalled the scripture that prophesied about the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 10, then the disciples went away again to their own homes. They returned probably because they feared future trouble. It was hard for them to know what the Jews or the Jewish leader would do upon discovering that the body is no longer in the tomb. So they returned and joined their fellow disciples and waited to hear from God. St. John Chrysostom believes that the two disciples, first, each one went to his own home as they felt amazed at what they saw. Then actually the resurrection started to touch their mind, so they returned and met with the other disciples in the upper room according to the commandment of the Lord. So while the two disciples hurried back to their fellow disciples, Mary Magdalene stayed by the tomb and wept, as we read in verse 11. But Mary stood outside by the tomb weeping. And as she wept, she stooped down and looked into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and the other at the feet, while the body of Jesus had lain. It was hard for her to leave the tomb without seeing the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. In her mind, he was stolen. So she saw two angels sitting there, one at the head and another at the feet. Matthew and Mark spoke about one angel. Luke spoke about two angels. Here, John spoke about two angels. He called them men because they appeared in human form in shining garments or white apparel. Saint Gregory the Great, he said, the angel seated at the head proclaims the divinity of Christ. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The other angel seated at the feet proclaims the incarnation of the Son of God, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. The angels marveled why she is weeping, because they expected her to be rejoicing that Jesus rose from the dead. That's why in verse 13 they asked her. Then they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "Because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." So they raised the question, "Why are you weeping?" It is as though they were telling her, "You should not weep." But she assumed that they asked this question to her because they don't know the cause of her tears. So she told them, "Because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." Mary thought that it was a sufficient reason for her to weep and to cry. Then actually, I believe Mary felt certain power around her. That's why in verse 14, now, when she had said this, she turned it around. She felt something. That's why she turned around. And she saw Jesus standing there and did not know that it was Jesus. So Mary did not realize that she is speaking with her Lord. That is Jesus. Who she has mistaken for the gardener, actually. Why does St. John include the exchange or the dialogue between Mary and the Jesus Christ? And why Mary did not recognize him? Some people say because the tears and the grief clouded her vision. But other fathers said it is a theological symbolism of the hidden Messiah. But John the Baptist did not recognize Jesus until the Holy Spirit descended as a dove on his head in baptism and revealed Jesus to John the Baptist that he is the Messiah. The disciples on the road to Emmaus in Luke chapter 24 did not recognize him until breaking of the bread at the supper. So it could be that his appearance is altered. Our Lord Jesus Christ, the risen Christ, he's in his glorified body. And now his disciples and Mary Magdalene are seeing him for the first time in his glorified body. Then Jesus actually asked Mary some question in verse 15. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" That is the same question of the angels. "Whom are you seeking?" She, Mary, supposing him to be the gardener, said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." So the Lord Jesus Christ repeated the same question of the angels, "Why are you weeping?" And also, he told her whom you are seeking, and this was mentioned in Matthew 28, verse 9 and 10. Whom are you seeking? Mary was not only weeping for the loss, but also she was inquiring after him. She was seeking him. Mary thought that he is the gardener. So Mary, in her reply, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." I want you to notice that she used the word him three times, referring to him, referring to the Lord Jesus Christ, just him. The omission of the name is understandable. She is so full of her loss that she assumes that others must know all about it. So when she says him to the gardener would realize about whom she is speaking. Her own mind is so entirely filled with one subject that she supposes to be in the mind of other. So what she is thinking, she is assuming it is in the mind of other. We can see here her passion and her eagerness, even after she recognized that this Jesus, you know, she was very, very zealous person. So, in a spiritual sense, a truly gracious soul is willing to do anything, to be at any trouble to enjoy Christ. Mary was willing to do anything, to go through any trouble to enjoy Christ. In the same way, any godly soul will be willing to do anything, to endure any trouble, to enjoy the company and the unity with the Lord Jesus Christ. The soul that dearly loves him, as Mary Magdalene, early and earnestly and with whole heart will seek after him, like Mary Magdalene. And his absence or the loss of his presence for a while will sharpen the desire after the Lord Jesus Christ. People with godly souls cannot endure his absence or even the loss of his presence for a very short time. And to that devoted love, to that devoted person like Mary Magdalene, the first word of the risen Lord are spoken. The first one the Lord spoke with her after resurrection was Mary Magdalene, because of her devotion, because of her love. She searched for him zealously and lovingly, and this qualified her to be the first to hear his joyful voice. So the voice of God is always most quickly heard by the heart that love him. Any heart that love him sincerely will hear quickly the voice of the Lord. Verse 16. Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him, "Rabboni," which is to say, teacher. When the Lord told her, "Mary," she had heard her name in a well-known voice. And this actually brought back to her mind all the old association. She said, this is must be Christ. It is the master. So she told him, Rabuni, which means literally my master. And actually, she fell at his feet to embrace him. And here actually, as the Lord said, the good shepherd, that the sheep recognize his voice. So the Lord here identified himself as a good shepherd, whose sheep actually know his voice. She recognized him when he said, Mary. Verse 17 and 18. Jesus said to her, do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father. But go to my brethren and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God. Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord and that she had spoken these things to her. This passage actually have given rise to a variety of interpretation. Why the Lord told her, do not cling to me or do not touch me. While the Lord Jesus Christ required Thomas to touch him, and he told him, put your hand in my side and at the print of the nails. So the question, why he asked Mary not to cling to him or not to touch him? There are many interpretation. Some suggested that she had cast herself at his feet, perhaps to be even more sure that it is the Lord's body, and that his words, when he told her, don't touch me or don't cling to me, he want to prevent her from just clinging to his feet to make sure that is a real body of the risen Christ. Or probably the reason for that, he knew that she would imagine that he will live with them on earth as Lazarus, after his resurrection, lived with them for some time. So he wanted to bring to her attention, no, I am ascending soon to my Father and your Father. Also, he wanted her to preach the resurrection and ascension. And he did not arise to establish earthly kingdom. That's why he told her, I did not ascend to my Father. So the emphasis here that he will ascend. I'm not here to establish earthly kingdom. He arose in order to ascend and establish his kingdom in our heart. St. John Chrysostom suggested that, having known the human Jesus, he is now asking her to show more respect for his glorified body. So she knew him before his resurrection and before his crucifixion. Now he is asking her to show respect to the glorified body. That's why he used, I did not ascend to my Father. Other scholars suggested that her desire is to cling to him, mean to keep bound to keep him bound to the earth, not to leave her and not to ascend. That's why he is telling her that his place is no longer in Jerusalem, but as our high priest offering himself as a true sacrifice, his place in heaven of heaven before the throne of the Father. Also, maybe he is urging her not to waste the time clinging to him, but go, you have a mission, run quickly to the apostles, share with them the news of resurrection and that you have seen me. The word cling or touch in the Greek word literally means fasten on or cling to or grasp. So, and the tense is present here, do not cling to me. And the prohibition is for not an individual act. It's not individual act for this moment only, but a continuous act, as if the Lord is telling her, do not continue to cling to me. Do not continue clinging to me. Now you have mission, go preach the resurrection. Stop clinging to me. Yes, you touched me. You hold my feet as we read in Matthew chapter 28. Now go do your mission. And the Lord told her, go and tell my brethren, my brethren. Now after the resurrection and the fulfillment of salvation, the follower of the Lord Jesus Christ have become daughters and sons of God the Father. So become brethren to the Lord Jesus Christ. So in this sense, all of us, we become brothers and sisters. We are born from the womb of the new covenant church. Then the Lord told her, I am ascending to my Father and to your Father. He is speaking here in the present tense, but this present tense is used for the future. As if he regards what will happen in the future as if it's happening at hand right now. Of course, he did not ascend right away. He stayed 40 days on earth. So the message to the brethren is an assurance that going on to the Father or ascending to the Father, as he spoke to them several times, especially on Covenant Thursday, the night of his crucifixion, was about to be realized after 40 days. Now the victory over death has been accomplished. That's now his appearance on earth will be temporary until he ascends into heaven and enter with his own blood into the heaven of heavens, as St. Paul explained in Hebrews. And here the Lord said, my Father and your Father, my God, your God. Because he is the Father of the Son, then he became our Father, because now we are brethren. But he is Father to the Son by nature, but to us by adoption. So his victory over death became our victory. And we became one with him. We rose in him, and also we ascended into the heaven, as St. Paul said, in him. So his ascension to heaven is the ascension of the human nature in him before the Father. In the Gospels, the Lord used to call God the Father my Father. Only one occasion he called him my God. Now he's using both, my God and my Father. My God because he is our God, and now Jesus is our brother, we are his brethren. So he called the Father my God. But by nature, he is his Father, and now he became our Father by adoption. So here actually, he by saying my Father, your Father, my God, your God, he would want to express the full relationship which embraces in him and his redeemed, the believers that he redeemed. But almost all church father emphasized that. He did not say our Father and our God, but he said my Father and your Father, my God and your God. He separated between two. So the Lord insisted to distinguish between him and us by saying, my Father, your Father, my God is your God. In order to emphasize that there is no equality with the Godhead of the Son of God. Yes, we are brethren, but he is son by nature, we are children by adoption. So He cannot say our Father or our God. There is distinction. And his relationship to the Father is totally distinct from our relationship to God the Father. Yes, in him, we can call the Father our Father, and we call him our God. In him. But the relationship of the Son with the Father is totally distinguished from our relationship with God the Father. That's why he said, my Father, your Father, my God, your God. So, he is our Father, he is our God, he is Father to the Son by nature, Father to us by adoption. So, first he said, I'm ascending to my Father, this natural relationship, and added your Father, that is the result of adoption. Mary heard these words, she directly obeyed the Lord, and immediately ran to the apostles to tell them that she had seen the Lord and what he told her. She was ready and willing to obey the commandment of her Lord with the utmost cheerfulness, and glad to go and to carry such news to the disciples, even though her interest and personal affection might have inclined her to desire to stay with Christ. And this is a perfect example of obedience. Sometimes I say, you know, I want to stay with Christ in solitary life or in retreat. I don't want to go to serve. Mary actually wanted to be with Christ, to cling to him. But once he told her, no, go, preach, actually she obeyed cheerfully against her own personal affection and desire to remain with Christ. And this is actually the meaning of the true obedience. This concludes actually our Bible study for tonight. I will give a quick summary in Arabic for our Bible study tonight. إنجيل يوحنا إصحاح 20 بيتكلم على قيامة المسيح من عدد 1 ل 18. ده الإنجيل اللي احنا بنقراه في قداس ليلة العيد. وده بيشرح لنا أحداث القيامة من كما رآها القديس يوحنا، لأنه كان شاهد عيان لما راح القبر. بيقول وفي أول الأسبوع جاءت مريم المجدرية إلى القبر باكرا والظلام باقي. أول الأسبوع اللي هو يوم الحد، لأن كان السبت ما قدروش يتحركوا فيها حسب الشريعة اليهودية. لكن في معنى رمزي هنا، إن هنا السبت استبدل بيوم جديد، بخليقة جديدة بقيمة المسيح، بحياة جديدة. أول الأسبوع، أول يوم في أسبوع جديد. جاءت مريم المجدرية إلى القبر باكرا والظلام باقي. في إنجيل متى نعرف إنها راحت مع مريم الأخرى اللي هي مريم كليوباس، وفي مرقس ولوقا إن المريمات. ربما مريم المجدرية راحت الأول، بعد كده مريم كليوباس راحت بعدها، وبعدين راحوا مجموعة من المريمات أو النساء للقبر. مريم كان المجدلية يمكن أول واحدة كانت تروح والظلام باقي، بيبان حبها ما كانتش حتى منتظرة حتى لما الشمس تطلع. فما فيش تعارض ما بين الثلاث أناجيل على إزاي بيقولوا مريم أو مريم المجدلية أو مريمات أو النساء، لأن ممكن يكونوا راحوا على دفعات. راحت فنظرت الحجر مرفوعا عن القبر. أول ما شفت الحجر على طول في ذهنها إن هما سرقوا الجسد، فرجعت بسرعة وجت لبطرس، فركضت وجاءت إلى سمعان بطرس وإلى تلميذ الآخر الذي كان يسوع يحبه اللي هو يوحنا كاتب الإنجيل، وقالت لهما أخذوا السيد من القبر ولسنا نعلم أين وضعوه. لسنا انتوا عارفين كلمة لسنا جمع، فده دليل ان مريم المجدلية ما كانتش لوحدها، يعني ما قالتش ولست اعلم اين وضعوه، لما تقول ولسنا يعني كانوا مجموعة من النساء شافوا القبر فاضي، الحجر متدحرج، فكلهم يعني قالوا كده ان الجسد اتسرق، فراحوا لبطرس ويوحنا وربما بقية المريمات راحوا يبلغوا بقية الرسل. أول ما سمعوا كده راح بطرس ويوحنا خرجوا للقبر. يوحنا شاب صغير جري بسرعة، بطرس يعني أكبر منه في السن راح متأخر، عشان كده يقول وكان الاثنان يرقدان معا فسبق التلميذ الآخر بطرس وجاء أولا إلى القبر وانحنى فنظر الأكفان موضوعة ولكنه لم يدخل. يوحنا بص كده لقى الأكفان موضوعة ما دخلش، ربما توقير لبطرس أكبر منه في السن فكان منتظره، أو ربما اتخذ بالدهشة لما لقى الأكفان والأكفان موجودة منظمة في مكانها، قال إيه ده؟ هي دي سرقة؟ ومعقولة اللي هيسرق يطبق الأكفان ويطبق المنديل؟ فوقف كده عمال يفكر هو إيه اللي حصل لغاية لما بطرس جه. فلما جه بطرس على طول يعني بيتحرك كده بمشاعره، فجاء سمعان بطرس يتبعه ودخل القبر ونظر الأكفان موضوعة. دخل بطرس القبر والمنديل الذي كان على رأسه ليس موضوعا مع الأكفان بل ملفوفا في موضع وحده. خلوا بالكم الأكفان موجودة والمنديل لوحده. ولما بطرس دخل يقول دخل أيضا التلميذ الآخر الذي جاء أولا إلى القبر ورأى فآمن. طب إيه اللي شافوه عشان يؤمنوا؟ وأمنوا بإيه؟ هل أمنوا أن الجسد اتسرق زي مريم المجدلية ما قالت، ولا أمنوا بالقيامة؟ تخيلوا لو حد عايز يسرق هيشيل الأكفان ويطبقها ويحطها في مكانها وياخد المنديل ويلفه ويحطه في مكان لوحده، استحال. ده اللي عايز يسرق بيسرق الجسد بالأكفان عشان يجري وكده. عشان كده هما لما شافوا ان الأكفان موجودة والمنديل اللي على راسه موجود لوحده، دي في ذاتها إثبات لحقيقة القيامة. والآباء بيقولوا ان السيد المسيح خرج من الأكفان دون أن يمسها، يعني الكفن كان مغطي السيد المسيح، هو خرج منها زي ما خرج من القبر والحجر ما زال موضوع. والكفن بتاع تورين الدراسات أثبتت أن السيد المسيح لما قام خرج دون أن يمس الكفن، يعني ما رفعش الكفن وقام، لا هو قام دون أن يمس الكفن. برضو عايز أقول لكم على حاجة لطيفة، العازر لما قام من القبر خرج ملفوف بالأكفان لأنه خرج بجسد مائت، مات بعد كده. إنما سيد المسيح ترك الأكفان لأنه خرج بجسد لا يموت، جسد القيامة، الجسد الممجد. عشان كده بنسميه باكورة الراقدين، يعني العازر قام قبليه، ابنة أرملة نين قامت قبليه، ابنة ياروس قامت قبليه. طب ليه بنقول على المسيح باكورة الراقدين؟ لأنه أول واحد يقوم بالجسد الممجد، الجسد غير المائت. يبقى الاثنين لما شافوا كده أمنوا بالقيامة، وفي آية 9 يأكد أنهم أمنوا بالقيامة، يقول لأنهم لم يكونوا بعد يعرفون الكتاب أنه ينبغي أن يقوم من الأموات. طب ده السيد المسيح قال لهم مرات كتير على القيامة، قال لهم ابن الإنسان يسلم في أيدي الأمم يصلبونه بعد 3 أيام يقوم من الأموات. يعني إيه لم يكونوا يعرفونه؟ ده رؤساء الكهنة كانوا عارفين موضوع القيامة ده، ده راحوا لبيلاطس وقالوا له احرس القبر واختمه، لأن المضل ده سمعناه بيقول إن هو هيقوم في اليوم الثالث. هما كانوا عارفين الكلمة بس مش فاهمينها يعني إيه؟ يعني إيه هيقوم؟ هيقوم في اليوم الأخير؟ يعني ما هي القيامة من الأموات؟ يقولك وكانوا يتساءلون فيما بينهم ما هو القيام من الأموات. فهنا لما أمنوا مش بس أمنوا، إنما أمنوا وفهموا الكتب في اللحظة دي، فهموا كل النبوات اللي اتكلمت على القيامة في اللحظة دي، عرفوا النبوات، ربنا فتح ذهنهم فعرفوا النبوات اللي بتتكلم على القيامة. بعد كده يقول فمضى التلميذان ايضا الى موضعهما. ربما ما كانوش عارفين اليهود هيتعاملوا معهم ازاي لما يعرفوا ان الجسد مش موجود في القبر، فرجعوا. يوحنا ذهبي الفم بيقول هم الاول كل واحد رجع لبيته وبعدين رجعوا تقابلوا مع بعيد الرسل، او يكونوا راحوا على طول على العلية مع بعيد الرسل. اما مريم فكانت واقفة عند القبر خارجا تبكي. مريم لسه مش مصدقة القيامة. مريم في ذهنها انهم سرقوا الجسد. وفيما هي تبكي انحنت الى القبر، بصت مرة تاني للقبر تتأكد هو فعلا الجسد مش موجود. فلقت ملكين بثياب بيض جالسين، واحد عند الرأس والاخر عند رجلين حيث كان جسد يسوع موضوع. متى ومرقس ذكروا ملاك واحد، لوقا ويوحنا ذكروا ملاكين. يعني ما فيش تعارض ما بين الروايات، لانه ممكن يكون ده واحد بيوصف ملاك بس لو كان جالس على الحجر، وده بيوصف الملاكين ان هم كانوا جوه القبر. لكن القديس غريغوريوس يقول الملاك اللي عند الرأس ده يمثل الميلاد الأزلي، في البدء كان الكلمة وكلمة كان عند الله وكان كلمة الله. والملاك اللي عند الرجل يمثل التجسد، والكلمة صار جسدا وحل بيننا. تأمل يعني في وجود المكانين. فالملاكين بيقولوا الملاكين سوري، فالملاكين بيقولوا لها يا امرأة لماذا تبكين؟ يعني هم عايزين يقولوا لها انت مش مفروض تبكي، ده المسيح قام من الأموات، انت بتبكي ليه؟ مفروض يبقى فرحان. انما هي فكرتهم ان هم ناس عاديين رجالة يعني، فبيسألوها بيقولوا لها انت بتبكي ليه؟ فبتشرح لهم السبب. فقالت لهم اخذوا سيدي ولست اعلم اين وضعه. بيقول ولما قال هذا التفتت الى الوراء. ايه اللي خلاها تلتفت وراها؟ في قوة في اللحظة دي هي حست بيها، حركة، حست ان في حاجة كده وراها. فبصت كده فلقت السيد المسيح، نظرت يسوع واقفا ولم تعلم انه يسوع. فقال لها يسوع الا سؤالين، سؤال اولاني بتاع الملائكة يا امرأة لماذا تبكين، والسؤال الثاني من تطلبي. يعني مريم المجدلية ما كانتش بس بتبكي ان هي مش لاقية المسيح او ان هو سرق الجسد، انما كانت بتطلب عايزة الجسد ده، تاخد الجسد فين. وده واضح في كلامها لما هي افتكرت ان البستاني، قالت له يا سيد ان كنت انت قد حملت قل لي اين وضعت وانا اخذ. وهنا اي نفس لها نفس الغيرة بتاعت مريم المجدلية تبكر باجتهاد تبحث عن ربنا، هتتقابل مع ربنا وربنا يعلن لها نفسه. زي ما ربنا القائم من الأموات أعلن نفسه أول مرة لمريم المجدلية بسبب اجتهادها وبسبب غيرتها وأنها بحثت عنه وكانت تطلبه من كل قلبها، هكذا كل نفس بتحب ربنا تبكر إليه تبحث عنه، ربنا هيظهر لها ويعلن نفسه لها. فربنا قال لها يا مريم، يا مريم الصوت ده انا عارفاه كويس. ففي اللحظه دي ادركت انه ده سيد المسيح، انا الصوت ده انا عارفه، زي ما قال خرافي تعرف صوتي. فالتفتت تلك وقالت له ربوني، ربوني معناه يا معلمي. قال لها يسوع لا تلمسيني. لا تلمسيني دي بتعمل اسئله كتير. ليه قال لها ما تلمسنيش بالرغم سمح توما يلمسه؟ في تفسيرات كتيرة. هي زي ما في إنجيل متى بيشرح أنها سجدت ومسكت بقدمي، وكأنها مسكت بقدمي عايز تتأكد أن ده جسد حقيقي، أن فعلا ده قام من الأموات، هي مش بتشوف روح ولا حاجة. فالسيد المسيح بيقول لها لا 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 ما تلمسنيش، يعني ما بلاش كده تلزقي بالطريقة دي. أو السيد المسيح بالإنجليزي don't cling to me، والكلمة اليوناني كلينج معناها يعني واحد يلاصق. فبيقولها لا أنا مش عايزك تبقى، يعني أنت عندك رسالة، الرسالة دي تروح وتبشر بالقيامة، فما تفضليش لازقه كده او ملاصقه روحي وبشري بالقيامه، لاني لم اصعد بعد الى ابي. انا لسه انا قاعد معاكم 40 يوم بس، بعد كده هصعد. انا مش زي العازر قمت وهقعد على الارض كام سنه واموت زي ما العازر، لا، انا مهمتي على الارض انتهت ولازم اصعد كرئيس كهنه، مكاني هو في السماء قدس الاقداس امام عرش الاب. برضو لا تلمسيني، عشان عايز يقول لها ان ده جسد القيامه الممجد، يعني تتعامل مع تديله احترام كجسد القيامه الممجد. ولكن اذهبي الى اخوتي، عندك رساله هنا، وقولي لهم اني اصعد الى ابي وابيكم والهي والهكم. وهنا برضو التركيز على انه صاعد، على انه صاعد. فهو عايز يقول لهم الصعود اللي كلمتكم عليه يوم الخميس ليله الصليب، خلاص انا تممت الصليب، قمت من الاموات، بعد 40 يوم انا هصعد للسماء، لان ده مكاني كشفيع ليكم هناك بدمي، هدخل الى الاقداس العليا بدمي عشان اكون شفيع ورئيس كهنه ليكم. بس هنا كل الاباء ركزوا على ان قال ابي وابيكم، الهي والهكم، ما قالش اني اصعد الى ابينا والهنا، لاني ابوة الاب للابن ده بالطبيعة، انما ابوة الاب لينا بالتبني. في المسيح بعد القيامة احنا بقينا اخوة، لان تبنانا الله الاب، عشان كده قال اذهب وقول لاخوتي. فلان احنا المسيح بيقول لله الاب ابي، يبقى هو ابونا، لان احنا بقينا في المسيح واحد. لكن واحد في فرق برضو، هو ابن بالطبيعة واحنا ابناء بالتبني، يعني ما ننساش ان احنا تراب ورماد، واحنا بنقول ربنا الهنا، عشان كده المسيح لانه بقى واحد معانا قال على الاب برضو الهي. لكن التركيز هنا قال ابي وابيكم الهي والهكم، عشان يقول برضو علاقتي مع الاب مختلفه تماما عن علاقتكم انتم مع الاب. انا علاقتي بالطبيعه انما انتم بالتبني. مريم المجدلية كان لها رغبة تبقى ملاصقة للرب، مش كده قال لها لا تلمسيني أو don't cling to me، لكن لما قال لها روحي وسابق إخوتي أطاعت. فجاءت مريم المجدلية وأخبرت التلاميذ أنها رأت الرب وأنه قال لها هذا. يعني أحيانا لو واحد مثلا في دير عايز يعيش حياة وحدة ورهبنة، يرفض مثلا أن يخدم لأنه عايز يتمتع بربنا. إنما هنا مثلا ربنا أول ما قال لمريم المجدلية روحي وكريزي، بالرغم رغبتها الداخلية أنها تبقى ملاصقة للرب، إنما سمعت الكلام وخرجت وكرزت. وهي دي الطاعة الحقيقية، الطاعة أن الإنسان ينفذ صوت ربنا حتى ولو ده ضد رغبته الشخصية وضد اللي هو عايز يعمله. ربنا يعطينا، احنا الاسبوع الجاي ده اسبوع الالام، بس هو جت البايبل استدي بدري شويه، لكن ربنا يعطينا ان احنا نحتفل بهذا الاسبوع، نتمتع به في شركه مع السيد المسيح، زي ما معلمنا بولس الرسول قال لا اعرفه وقوه قيامته وشركه الامه، لالهنا المجد الدائم الى الابد امين.